Today's Mailbag Monday openings are paired with Surly Brewing Company's Rocket Surgery Hazy Ale. I was not expecting it to be that light. Oh, Surly Brewing Company is from Minneapolis. Well, this should be interesting anyway. Let's get into this mail and this beer. Wow, that is super citrusy. I was not expecting that at all. Anyway, first thing in, don't know what it is because it doesn't have a customs declaration on it. We'll just have to find out together. It is a couple of modules. Oh, that looks like a microcontroller. I think that's an Attiny85 base microcontroller. Yep, Attiny85. Okay, so this is essentially a DigiSpark style board, probably, especially if it has the DigiSpark bootloader on it. Some of them do, some of them don't. Not sure. But I got two of them, so let's check the listing and see what's what. Attiny85 USB Development Board for Arduino. Currently they are selling for $4 each with free shipping. Back when I bought them, they were $1.80 each, which is why I bought two, because that is a really good price. Doesn't say much more about them down here. Okay, we'll just have to play with it for a second and see what happens. I guess the first thing we'll do is just plug it in and see what happens. Oh, it looks like it's got a blink sketch on it. Okay. But you notice how that blink sketch started immediately? That tells me that this doesn't have the DigiSpark bootloader on it, because the DigiSpark bootloader delays for a few seconds before it starts running the program. That's okay, we can work with this. It's just good to know what you're dealing with. And I could throw the bootloader on there if I choose to, or I could just run them the way they are. Doesn't matter, either way, it's a pretty good deal for a handy little microcontroller. Because that's what's running this part of this one up here, for instance. One very, very similar to that. And it does have the DigiSpark bootloader on that one. So it's relatively easy to do. Anyway, next mail item. This one says 5015 fan. Okay. It is two fans. And these, if I remember correctly, and if I ordered the correct thing, are spares or replacement fans for the hot end on my 3D printer and for the part cooling fan. If I ordered the right things, I'll have to check that. Now, the fans on my printer are not giving me problems yet, but I have only put a couple of spools of filament through them since I got it, so I wouldn't expect them to either, but I just don't want to be caught short if I'm doing something that's critically important and they die. Oh. And these are both branded Big Tree Tech as well, and they're both 24 volt fans, which makes me increasingly confident that I got the right thing. Anet A6 A8 DC cooling fan, 5015 turbo fan, 4010 fan, 12/24 volt hot end extruder case. Yeah, I got these from ACO Market with free shipping for $8.01 Canadian for the pair of them. They have a bunch of different options. I could have got 12 volts or just one fan at a time, but I decided to grab the two of them together. Interesting that the ones that they show there don't say that they're from Big Tree Tech, but the ones that I got are. I did check the measurements and when I ordered them, and I'm like 99% sure this is the ones that I need for the Ender 3 V2. But I guess I'll find out in due course. Next in, it says expansion board module. Always a popular choice and always a likely possibility. Well, fairly well packaged. Looks like a power supply. Comes with a fairly beefy and lengthy heat sink. Is that intended to go across a bunch of components? That's weird. Especially since it doesn't actually fit in there. Oh well, big heat sinks are always useful. Aha, yes, this is in fact a power supply. And it has a constant current potentiometer and a constant voltage potentiometer. So that is good for all manner of things. Oh, hey, there we go. Input 5 volts to 30 volts, output 0.5 volts to 30 volts. Anyway, one of the really handy uses for this and what it looks like it's designed for is charging lithium batteries, because lithium batteries, as we all know by now, need to be charged in two different phases. First, in a constant current or current limited phase. Then once that current starts dropping off, it switches to a constant voltage phase until it reaches the finished voltage, and then it stops. You see here there is a charging LED, a full LED, and a constant current LED to tell you what's going on. So that could come in handy. And I mean, I've got a few of them around here, and I've got one of them set up to charge my drill batteries. But it's always useful to have another one in stock for any number of things. I would also like to find out what the current handling capability of this thing is. That could come in useful as well.
CC, CV, adjustable 3 amp, 35 watt, DC 5 to 30 volts, 2 DC 0.5 to 30 volts, step up, step down, buck boost converter, power supply module, voltage regulator. I got this for the princely sum of $2.64 from DIY More Alice 110-1983 store on AliExpress. That's a familiar name to long-term Mailbag fans, and not just Mailbag fans from my channel either. So I paid $2.64 for it, plus $2.96 shipping, total of $5.47. So, okay, 3 amps. I'm assuming that's with that heatsink put on in that position where it doesn't actually fit and stuck onto a few different components. Oh, okay. So they're claiming that even without the heatsink, it'll run up to 3 amps. I think I'd probably want to put the heatsink on it anyway. It has short circuit protection. It has low voltage protection. It does not have reverse connection protection. Important safety tip. Yeah, just basic instructions. Adjust the constant voltage to get the voltage you need, and then adjust the constant current to set the current limit on it. That's about all there is to it.
So typically I do 5 items in my mailbags, and today the 4th item is something that Harold from Beaverton, Ontario sent me. Yes, there really is a place called Beaverton, Ontario. And yes, it is probably the most Canadian-sounding place name that we have. Oh, well. It's a bunch of circuit boards and a note. Harold says he just watched one of my Mailbag Mondays and thought I could use these little items. He noticed that I tinker with Arduinos. Now and again, yes. He has included a kit that he designed for his N-scale model railroad. This is the first version, and he's missing a couple of pull-up resistors on the I2C clock lines. So, but it is not a complicated kit to assemble. He's got his address hidden down here, so that is cool. Let's look at these circuit boards first, and then we'll take a peek at the kit in a second. Well, that's a whole bunch of little boards. Okay, so they have 8 pins lined up, probably for pin header, and then 8 pins for components on there. Okay, interesting little breakout board. And then we have the kit. So we have a socket and we have a microcontroller, I assume. MCP23017-ESP. I am not familiar with that one. I'm going to assume that he pre-programmed it. I hope. We have a few resistors. We have a single inline resistor package. Some headers. And this board which breaks them all out. I do like that when breakout boards for microcontrollers have the GPIOs broken out into sets of 3. Because those 3 are the 2 voltage rails and then that GPIO. So that is nice, because then you've just got 3 pins right there with everything you need. There, I'm assuming, is where the... Yeah, the SIL resistor goes in, just like that, and there's another one over there. Very cool. I'm going to have to get in touch with Harold and just find out a little bit more about this board. Nicely laid out board, though. Through the magic of editing, I have contacted Harold, and I should have recognized what this is. This little board is a breakout board for these RJ45 jacks. That is a perfect fit. Thank you, Harold. And in the email between Harold and I, he also answered my question about this MCP23017, which again, I should have looked up. It is a SCL and SDA, in other words, I squared C, controlled 16-bit or 16 GPIO expander kind of a thing. And the reason I should have recognized it is I have a couple of very similar chips here, the MCP23S17, which is just a very slightly different version of the same chip. That's enough from the future. Back to the regular mailbag. And the final thing in is this huge box here. And just the way it arrived to my house with a pile of stuff as the addressee, I'm confident that this came from one of my sponsors. It's probably a review sample, although it doesn't say on the box, other than the fact that it came from Amazon, what it is or who it came from. Oh, there's a little packing slip in here. Now I know what it is. This came from KAIWEETS via Amazon. Seriously, Amazon? This huge box for that? Anyway, this is a KAIWEETS digital multimeter model HT112B. When they asked if I wanted to take a look at another one of their multimeters, I said sure, and this one jumped out at me because it looks like it has a huge screen on it. And it seems to. So what do we have in the pouch? Spare fuse. 4 2032 batteries, cells, and a set of test leads, which are quite flexible, actually. Okay. So I'm guessing I'm going to have to put those batteries in the back here. Take off the, what does Dave call these? A rubber buggy baby bumper. And we have a screw by the looks of it on the battery compartment. And so those just drop in. Oh, it's tight. Oh, those are tight to get in there. Okay, there we go. There we go, and it chirped to life. Good. So cover that up. I'm not going to do a full teardown of it right now, of course. If you'd like to see a teardown, let me know. But anyway, it comes up into auto mode. Let me just power that off. Power it back on. Okay. Put the probes on. So what do we have here? Oh, these are not standard size probes. These are much smaller than normal. Here's a standard one that comes with an awful lot of meters. Okay. That's interesting. Means if I damage them, I'm going to have a bit of a pain trying to get replacements. But I guess the answer to that is just don't damage them. So it seems to have, it's in automatic mode. It's got smart functions. It is a selector down there. I suppose I could read the manual, but should I have to? So it claims to be automatic. Wow, let's find an angle that you guys can see it without glare. So if we short the probes, does it recognize that as? It does. It goes, it shows it's 0.10 ohms and it is chirping. Okay, that's good. We can take those off there. That's good. What do we have around here that we can test? How about a 9-volt battery? I test it. Yeah, I'll do it properly. 7.1 volts. I have a 9-volt battery that's not dead. Okay. So it senses those pretty easily. It says it is Cat 3 rated and that it is good to 600 volts. So let's try it on my EU transformer here. Should be about 220-ish volts. Come on, make contact, you. There we go, 232 volts. Okay. Which is about what I would expect from this 220-volt transformer. I guess it's it does what you would expect it to do. Let's see what the buttons do here. Okay, that just puts it into standard modes. All right. NCV live. Okay, let's try that. Let's power this guy back on. It is a transformer after all. Hear that chirping away? Okay. Yep, okay, so the non-contact voltage works, that's good. What does that selector do? I don't know. I will have to read the manual. But it does look like an interesting little meter, and as I said, the thing that jumped out at me right away was this huge screen that, compared to my other meters, you know, compared to all the other meters that I've got around here, I think that screen is going to show up better on camera for you guys, which is one of the reasons I chose this one out of the ones that they offered. So we'll have to see how that works out. KAIWEETS Digital Multimeter HT112B Auto Ranging 6000 Counts True RMS Portable Multimeter. Currently from Amazon.ca, the discounted price is $38.99. All right. What do they have to say about it? An ultra-portable multimeter. Yeah, it is small. It's handheld or pocket size even. Very suitable for carrying in the car, for camping, or for DIYer and homeowner. Yeah, that's reasonable. I wouldn't consider this to be necessarily a professional electrician's meter, just because of the low current reading and the small jacks and stuff like that. And even though it says it's rated for 600 volts, the manual says don't use it over 250. If that's the range that you work in and you want something small and handheld, this seems to be a reasonable little meter for what I can see right now. And there is the contents of today's Mailbag Monday haul. Quite the selection as usual, and a couple of interesting surprises. Shipping times, these two Attiny85 boards took 18 days because they came from a Canadian warehouse. The two fans took 41 days from China, and the power supply, power converter, constant current, constant voltage module took 42 days also from China. And then of course, the meter, because it was from Amazon, only took a couple of days to get here, and I didn't see a postmark on the stuff from Harold, so it probably just took a week or two to get here from his place in Beaverton, Ontario. Well, thanks everybody for watching. I always appreciate that. Thanks to Harold for sending this stuff, and I'm going to be in contact with you about them in a little while. You put your email address hidden in the package, so I'll do that. And thank you to KAIWEETS for generously supplying this multimeter for me to show off and use in future videos. Oh, and as always, thanks to my Patreon supporters for keeping my beer fridge full and helping to pay for some of the stuff in the mailbags. I truly appreciate that, guys. Right, that'll do it for this time. Comments and questions down below in the comments section, as usual. I'll talk to you later.